I'm going to welcome everybody. Thank you all for coming. I think you'll find this talk very interesting, maybe provocative. I wanted to just very quickly introduce our main speaker. This is sponsored by the Multicultural Community, part of African American History Month. My name is Ron Weisberger. I'm the member of the committee as a director of the Holocaust Center. One of the things that we do in the multicultural community is try to feature speakers, especially during this month, although something you want to do throughout the year, featuring different aspects of African American history and culture. So we're really pleased, I'm very pleased to be able to introduce Dr. Spencer Holland, who actually was classmate of mine, no matter how old you are, right? Yeah, we both got great. He doesn't look as old as I am, but anyway, we were classmates way back in New Jersey at State College, and he went on to do some great things. I went on to do something. I've actually was very fortunate to end up here at BCC. Dr. Holland has taught in a number of places, both secondary and elementary school. He also went on after his undergraduate work to get a doctorate at Columbia University in psychology, where he started to do the research both on his own experience teaching, but also experience as a researcher at Columbia University, which is in New York City. He's also taught at Howard University and Morgan State University in Baltimore. And so he's taught, as I said, at any number of levels. And he's been somewhat, as he'll tell you, he's been somewhat retired, but people like he and I don't retire. You know, we're not rocking chair people. And he's been very busy. He's been volunteering in the schools of the District of Columbia. He's lived in Washington, D.C. for many years. And not only has he volunteered, but he's been continuing doing the kind of research that you'll hear about from the ground up. And again, he brings a wealth of experience, as you can tell, both, as I say, as a practitioner, as well as a researcher. Sometimes people say, well, research is a kind of volunteer. Well, he's done both. He's both been on the ground, and he's also done the research and brought them all together. So I'm very pleased to be able to introduce Dr. Spencer Holland.
I haven't done this in so long. I hope my voice holds out. But boy, am I excited. I have always loved teaching. Is it? Wait, I think I got it. Okay. I'm going to show you a video that will explain almost 30 years of my work. I started this whole project because of what's going on in primary grades. You hear a whole lot about what is going on with African American males, but nobody ever talks about the little boys. And this is where it starts. K through three, you learn to read. Fourth grade through graduate and professional school, you read to learn. Okay, I'm gonna say it again. K through three, you learn to read. Fourth grade through graduate and professional school, you read to learn. What is happening with our boys, and has been happening for decades, is that they fail to learn to read. K-3 are pushed into fourth grade. That's where they drop out. Now, how many of you remember your first grade teacher? Everybody remembers Miss Levy. 70 years ago, I had Miss Levy. Because Miss Levy is the one that taught me all the rudiments that I was going to need to know how to read. And what is happening to our little black boys in urban systems particularly is that they are not learning to read for a whole host of reasons. But they are not learning to read, and then they're socially promoted in fourth grade. By sixth grade, they're three grade levels behind tag special ed. They're not special ed. They never learned to read in the first place. And this is where their anger and their shame begins to turn them into the kind of young men and older boys that we see in our inner cities. They lack compassion, they lack empathy, because they have been dumped on from fourth grade on. So, what I did initially, which we'll show here, I decided that most of these boys do not have positive, very positive male role models in their lives. We know this. We know that the homes they come from are ill-equipped to help them in this educative process. We know this. So why do we keep blaming it on mom? Why do we keep blaming it on the home? It is not mama's job to teach anybody ABCs, how to count. It is our job. And we have not done it. We have failed these children miserably. So before I show you this, President Obama has a new initiative, recent initiative, called My Brother's Keeper, that is focused on the problems that African-American males have in America. And we are our brother's keepers. But the kind of work I did 20, 30 years ago is not possible, because getting men to volunteer to serve as teacher aides in first grade, second grade, and third grade classes would be difficult this year. I call it the Catholic Church Syndrome. The suspicion about it has always been there. I was an early childhood person from the time I went into education, but in the 60s and 70s, a man that wanted to teach first and second grade, what's wrong with you? There's something wrong. Are you gay? Are you a pedophile? So when I got my master's degree in early childhood, they made me an administrator. I wasn't allowed to work with the little kids. But they were the ones that needed me most. So hopefully this is about 12 minutes, will give you an idea of what I've been doing and what I'm going to try to do before I leave this coil. See, people, do you know it's great being a senior? Oh, it is fabulous. I wore glasses for 50 years. Had cataracts, 20/20 vision. I had a bunion on this thing that on my foot that bothered me for 15 years. Had it cut off. 10 years of being retired was God's gift to me. He gave me a chance to rest. Being in charge of other people's lives is stressful, to say the least. And boy, was I involved in their lives. I created a program at an inner city school in Washington, D.C. called Project 2000, when the class of the year 2000 entered first grade. I trained men to serve as teacher assistants for 1 half-day per week in their classrooms, either all morning or all afternoon. If you couldn't do that, you couldn't be a part of this program. Now, it was an intervention for primary grades, my area. Let's get them reading by fourth grade. we were so successful that the parents, the kids, the teachers, everybody wanted us to stay with these kids, fourth through sixth grade at the time. It got me off my focus, but I had fallen in love with a group of kids that I had been with for 6 years. So I created a nonprofit. I left the university. I went from teaching doctoral students to seventh graders in 1 month. And that program lasted 11 years. And one of the reasons it failed is after I retired, it was one of those founder, executive director kind of situations where the founder will work without money and will pay staff before he gets paid. All that took place. So they could not find someone who would sacrifice that much and accept $55,000 a year as a salary for 24/7 work. I hope this explains what I did and how successful we were. And then all of it was shut down because they said it was discriminatory toward girls. I said to them, girls in the inner city are not killing each other. The boys are. The girls make mistakes later on in their educational career. And many of them go back to school, graduate from high school, go on to college with their baby because they already knew how to read when they screwed up. Once a boy is 3 to 4 years behind, it is almost impossible, not impossible, but it's almost impossible for him to catch up. And he's gonna be tagged special ed. So this 15 minute piece will give you some idea of how far spread the idea that I put out there got. 60 Minutes, Oprah Winfrey, I was all over this country. And every time we set up a program, it was successful. For the National Organization of Women, the NAACP, Legal and Defense Fund, the ACLU, and closed them all down. They had done what they were supposed to. The boys knew how to read. But they closed them down anyway. The reason I quit Morgan State and took these children 7th and 12th grade is because I knew that if I sent them to the junior high schools in the section of the city where this elementary school was located, I had a doctoral student who did our dissertation on this group when they were in fifth grade. And at the end of sixth grade, 85% of the children were at or above grade level. They were reading on the eighth grade level. They were doing math on the seventh and eighth grade level. Woo, were they ready for junior high school? And if I had sent them to the two junior high schools in that inner city community, they would have been lost. So I spent the next 10 years, 7 years, 6 years, making sure that they got through. Now, all of them didn't stay with me, but the 10 that stayed with me all went to college. And all of the children behind them that stayed the whole 6 years also went to college or went to their I said, I want you to pass that military test at the level so that you can say, I'm going into the Air Force. The Air Force and the Navy require really high schools. Army and Marines, less. But almost all of them ended up in the Air Force or the Navy. So what I'm doing today is I'm going to try to get the society to focus again on our little black boys. These are our babies. And for the past 3 years, I have worked as a teacher aide in the first grade class, Tuesdays and Wednesdays. And every boy in all of those classes, reading at the second and third grade level. Now, the girls enjoyed my presence, but they never fought to work with me. they were not as excited as those little boys. And I taught in a school that was primarily in the Hispanic section of the city. But I've always told people, six-year-olds are six-year-olds, and I can charm a six-year-old, I don't care where he comes from. And they loved it, and I loved it. So I'm on a quest again to be my brother's keeper. Now, I'm not going to be able to do it the way I did it before, but later on I'm going to tell you about a cadre of volunteers that is perpetual, will always be here, and a group of little boys that will always be here. So we have a mechanism now, not the same as Project 2000, but same in many ways, but using different kinds of volunteers. Thank you, sir. The last part of this was Senator Arlen Specter was one of the major donors. He got me earmarks to keep this program going. The major problem with the program is they wanted me to take it to scale. And by scale, give me a break. There was only three of us. And the money, the first 3 years, I went from making almost $100,000 a year. The first year it was $18,000. My mama paid my rent and she helped me buy food. And they all thought I was out of my mind because I took my pension up to that point to start the program because I thought God has taken care of me, okay? I married well, but I have no pension. But that's beside the point. What I'm doing today is saying that even though this kind of program can't use adult men, what about all the high school boys that are in all of our high schools, in all of our cities? Big brothers teaching little brothers is not a new idea. Any of you who have had an older brother, older sisters but by the time you get to be a teenager, what have you, older sisters are no longer your boss, because you can beat her, okay? But your older brother is your boss until you can beat him. I was an older brother, and I had an older brother. I taught my younger brother his ABCs and how to count and how to add. My older brother helped me with that. So what I'm suggesting, since we can look at the research, the appalling level of failure of African-American little boys in first, second, and third grade is a scandal. Nobody's talking about it. They used to say to me, oh, here he comes again, Holland, he's Johnny One Note. Oh, the boys can't read, the boys can't. And I used to take on all kinds of programs like whatever social program. I said, but if the boys can't read, and I used to tell the boys, you gotta believe these people. You don't know whether they're telling the truth. Learning to read helps you check on people telling you stuff, teachers or anybody. Try to imagine not being able to read. You cannot. You don't know how you did it, but you know this. Your first grade teacher was a part of it. Your parents were a part of it. But basically, it was learning what digraphs are. What's the difference between a W and a W when the W is WH and the W is a W? What is the difference between an SH, a SH, and a SH when it is an SH and a SH? These are the kinds of things Miss Lee taught us. These are the kinds of things that build on how the sound, you're learning what words. I say to kids, oh, you've used that word 100 times. Now, come on, sound it out. Now say it fast. Oh, that's what it is. It is one of the beauties of being a teacher that I have always found was that it then came the dawn look that you get from your students. I taught math and science in junior high when I first started, and oh my Lord, it was just wonderful. You're up there straining to get, and one of them gets it. You could see it Yes, I mean, now you tell him and tell him. This is the kind of joy and, you know, positive reinforcement you get as a teacher that kept me coming back and back and back, because every teacher knows you didn't know that when you came in here. And I'm being retarded. Me, teaching a kid his ABCs, how to write a oh, they use uppercase and lowercase now. They don't use capitals and small letters. But just that, every day I was in that classroom, I left knowing that I had taught a couple of kids something they didn't know before. And that is the beauty of teaching. Now, it also helps to understand that our older boys can do this. Let's train them. You don't need a lot of training to teach a kindergartner how to write an A. What kind of training do you need to teach a kindergartner to count to 20? That is an accomplishment for a kindergartner, for a five-year-old, counting to 20. First graders generally cannot count to 100 when they first walk in. And getting them to that point and subtracting two and adding two-digit numbers, they don't teach carrying the one anymore. Okay? Oh, no, no, no. They are teaching first graders the proof. That's what that new core curriculum does. This is why parents cannot help their children with their homework. Because the parents say, well, no, you carry the one. The kids say, what do you mean? What is it? But that's a 10 and that's a 1. But the 10s and the 1. And the parent has no clue. What are you talking about, 10s and 1s? Carry the 1. Put the 1 up there and add it up. That isn't happening anymore. And it's really hard. This is, learning to read is not an easy task. Can you imagine learning the Chinese alphabet, the Japanese alphabet, the Arabic alphabet? But they do it, and our kids do it also. So what I'm saying is, we have got, before I do that, this is what got me back out of the room. He told the truth. He's called the James Baldwin. Modern day James, but he's even better than James Baldwin. This is a book he wrote to his 15-year-old son to explain to him what it's going to be like to be a black man in America. I cried through the first reading. Cried through the second reading, the third reading, I finally got through. But this, he just won the National Book Award for nonfiction. Everybody should read it. And those of, particularly those who have a view of African American males that is, let's say, skewed, to put it mildly.
Who is it, Dr. Spencer? Who's the author?
His name is Ta-Nehisi Coates. Between the World and Me. He's trying to explain to this boy what my father explained to me, but not in the easy way he's explaining. No, my father said to me, that white man ain't gonna say please. I said to him once, well, I think I was a senior because I was getting ready to leave home, otherwise I wouldn't have said it. You never say please or thank you. He said, that man ain't gonna say please or thank you to me. I said, get your ass out there and cut that grass. Hard lesson. But he was right. I ran out of gas once. I was 21 years old. I was out doing what 21-year-olds do. You know, on the way over, I ran out of gas. So I left the car on the highway and hitched my way home. And remember, I'm 21 years old. Next morning, I'm hungover now. I'm 21. My father, I hear this coming up the stairs, woke me up. Threw open the door. Is that your so-and-so car out there on the highway? Yes. I ran out of gas. I'll go get it. No, you go get your ass up right now and go get it. I had broke down in a white area. Ran out of gas in a white area. This is in 1960.
Okay?
In southern New Jersey. Now, southern New Jersey was a lot like Maryland, Delaware. It wasn't in the South, but the name fit. Okay? I lived in a county where no black people lived in the county seat until the 70s. I went to school there, my fourth grade through eighth grade. The only, the joke was, the only black people that sleep in Mays Landing are those that are in the county jail. And it was true. So this 21-year-old got up with his mouth poked out, of course, and followed his father. Yes. And the whole time, do you know what not? You were out there in the dark that night. In fact, it was 2 o'clock in the morning. And you know what could have happened to you when they saw a black man? What? Oh, Lord. I took it. I didn't say a word, just gritted my teeth and what have you. I'm 76, and I have never run out of gas. Never. That's the kind of teaching our fathers had to do. But you do have to prepare black boys. Now, give you an example. I had a 12-year-old. God, he was 6 foot tall, 12 years old. And he came crying to me about how people were treating him in the store. Why are they doing this? I had to explain it to him. You look like a grown black man now. You don't look like a child anymore. Old men and young boys are not a threat in America. But you have to explain to your children, your boys, and explaining this to little boys, you can't explain it to little boys. You've got to demonstrate it. They've got to have somebody in their lives who can say, no, you can do better than this. And it's not dependent on what your mama does. It's depending on what your teachers do. Because your teachers are being paid to do this, not your mama. And there's no excuse for the fact that in one instance I have just read recently where in a preschool, 4-year-old program, pre-K program, where black boys constituted only 18% of the total student population. However, they constituted 40% of the 4-year-olds who were suspended from school. 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds put out of the educative environment because the adults didn't know what to do. Are you mad? He's 5. What? You don't know what to do. He's 7. I have had problems with acting out, boys and what have you, but I'm the adult. No, you're not going to do this. You're not going to do this here. One of the things we used to do in this program is have the men make sure these boys understand. I understand you have to have some of these behaviors on the playground, in the community where you live, but you drop them at the school door. You don't bring them in here. Just like you don't bring it into church. You don't bring it in here. But it's got to be, this is the, some of the men would say, but I told him that yesterday. Well, give me a break. You got to tell a 14-year-old something 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 12 times. What do you think you got to tell a 5-year-old? Of course you got to tell him over and over and over. That's part of teaching little kids. The repetition. Every morning you start by doing the alphabet. Or the parts of the alphabet, particularly your vowels. It goes on the whole year, every morning. The structure, and you've got to do it over and over. Now, when we were undergraduates, we had a philosophy professor that was really, really incredible. And everybody had to take philosophy. One of the things that stuck with me, that was in our sophomore, he cited a philosopher, I've never been able to find out who it was, that's why I put it in this article as anonymous, and said, civilizations march in the footsteps of their children. Now listen, look at all the civilizations that have gone under, and look at how they treated their children. And America is no better. We do not treat children well. That's why some of the situations that we've seen over the years were allowed to go on so long. A young man just got caught in Prince George's County in Maryland, who had been abusing children and taking photographs of them in the school for over a year. And nobody caught him. These are the kinds of things I do not and have never believed that America was a child-centered society. It isn't. They don't vote. We treat our children pretty bad, as far as I'm concerned. That core curriculum is a killer. But we are also preparing them for a world we have no concept of. But just imagine the kind of technology you are all using right now. That's the world these children are going to grow up in. If they do not learn to operate computers, you've got to know how to read. So just throwing computers at them, they're going to go play games. They can play games, but you've got to be able to read to do the real work that computers do. No one has focused on our little boys, and this is where all of the problems begin. If we are going to do something about the kind of situation we have, let's say in Chicago, God, you know, the black guys are murdering each other like crazy. They hate each other. And one of the things that happens in male groups, let me just give you an example. Working on a construction crew with all the guys. If you're a slacker, the foreman doesn't have to follow you. Fire you. Who's going to fire you? Who's going to get you fired? The fellas. Working on a basketball team, a football. This is why I structured this like a team thing, because it was for the boys. They were called scholars. A varsity scholar is any kid that gets a 2.5 grade point average or above who has no D's. 3.0, your first team. 3.5, you're all star. 3.75, you are an All-American. That's the honor roll that I put out at the end of every grading period. And they were required to maintain a 2.5 to stay in good standing with Project 2000. 2.5 is 2 B's and 3 4 C's. You got a 2.5. Most people graduate from college with 2.5, 2.6 grade point averages, not 3.0s and 3.5s. Most people graduate in that C plus B minus area. So that's, hey, you can read. These are the kinds of things that I'm working on now. The other area, primary grade teachers. They have never been given the respect that they deserve or the help that they need, particularly in this day and age. Now, in the District of Columbia school system, and that's the one I'm most familiar with because I've lived there for 40 years and I worked in that system off and on, maybe 10 years, they didn't want to hear it either. Now, this is the only system in America. This is where it becomes controversial. And my message is for African-American people. It's not for America in general, because these are our children. Now that system has a black mayor, predominantly black city council, a black school chancellor, 70% black principals, 80% black teachers, and a 50% graduation rate for black boys. Now, where do they get off blaming systems that have black children and white children, and they see the black children so far behind the white children? Okay, there's a problem there, of course. But you are doing it for your own. So who the hell do you think you are telling me? That's what these systems say back. You can't say anything to me until you can show me that you can do it. And we aren't doing it. So I'm taking them to task. And I wasn't popular before, and I'm not popular now, because I know sooner or later I'm going out of here. That's another perk of being old. You know, afraid of dying. Because you know you might not die, wake up tomorrow. That makes you even more whatever. I wrote on the board once, I wrote the word curmudgeon out for the kids. They had me so frustrated and made them look it up. I told them they were turning me into what? It wasn't them. If we don't help our primary grade teachers, very little's going to change in inner city urban education. In the district, kindergarten teachers have a full-time teacher aide all day long, 5 days a week. First, second, and third grade teachers also need full-time teacher aides if we're going to get these children reading on the fourth grade level. And until we do this, we have to accept the responsibility of the fact that it's our fault. It's completely our fault. So, if the school and the village does not help the homes that we know these children come from, who cannot do what we know needs to be done, then we have to do it. Project 2000 was the village partnering with the school to overcome the deficits that the home had. We need outside help to bring these boys. What I'm suggesting, there's a all of the remediation, or whatever you want to call it, that is being applied to this group of children is happening at the middle school or high school level. That's a little bit too little, too late. Now, the district is opening for the first time an all-boys high school in the fall. And it's going to be a lottery. They hope to start a freshman class of 150 kids. And I think they say so far they have about 400 kids that have applied. So they're going to choose them randomly. Now, what they're going to end up with, 150 boys, with over half of them reading below ninth grade. And that will happen over and over and over until they begin to tackle the problem where it starts, first through third grade, really kindergarten. At the end of kindergarten now, kids are supposed to know their ABCs, know how to read, and count at least 20. And be able to add and subtract one-digit numbers. That was something we were not even exposed to until first grade. So, if this school hope, now, I'm praying that it's successful. However, look at what you're dealing with. And they're gonna have to have a lottery every year. So, look at the work they're gonna have to do with upwards of 70 or 80 of those boys before they can even begin teaching them freshman level classes. I said that to them and they didn't take it well. But I'm going to continue to say it to them. Because that is one of the places where these children, if we can get them to volunteer to serve one day a week in a kindergarten class as freshmen, and then move with those kids the next year as sophomores, And then the third year, second grade, the fourth year, third grade, what I envisioned as two groups of kids graduating and moving on to the next level with the appropriate level of skill. And that's all I'm asking. Teach them to read. And once we know that a boy that is acting out in fourth or fifth grade has the academic skills, we know we've got to look at something else that's causing this behavior and stop blaming it on the fact that, he just won't do the work. No, he's on grade level. There's something going on in his home. And the last thing before I throw this open for the cover. Oh, I'm sorry. What are we going to do? How are we going to do it? And it must be done by us. The African American community, celebrate African American history, but let's take care of our babies. It is so sad to see little boys crying because the fellas begin to get on you. Fourth, fifth, sixth grade. That's where all the anger toward each other. You may be able to shoot three pointers, but you can't breathe. Whoa. I have yet to hear a kindergarten, first or second grade child, boy, say, I hate school. You don't hear that in third grade. Because now third grade, I gotta get this, I don't have it together. That's when those little boys, 5 and 6 years old, come to school just as anxious and happy to be in school and learning, but something happens. I'm not blaming it on the teacher, because I have been in situations where the teacher had 2 emotionally disturbed boys in a class of 21. 2. Now this mainstreaming, I worked in special ed for 10 years. Mainstreaming is something that I support. However, when a child is emotionally disturbed and he's mainstreamed, it is not helping him, nor is it helping the other children or the teacher. And the other thing these kids know, and this is the last thing before I ask you for any response, these kids know you can't touch me. I watched a black female principal and a black male vice principal spend 20 minutes coaxing a little boy out of the cloakroom while the teacher's trying to teach 20 other people. Now, in my day, in our day, but this boy knows you cannot touch him. The other thing I witnessed in this inner city school I worked in is when there is a problem and the teacher calls the office, they send the security guard up to get the child. This is this boy's first introduction to official authority in a uniform. It's sad. But there is something we can do about it. Get our big brothers, like his, my brother's keeper. We can and we should be our little boys' brother's keepers. I thank you. I think I'm losing my voice. I haven't done this in so long. But do you have any questions, comments, or what have you? I'm sorry you didn't get to see the rest of this, because I stayed with that group of kids for 12 years. That kind of personal commitment is not, you can't find it much anymore. But it's necessary. It was necessary. It got me off track. It got me off my high horse about my little boys, because I had to do this. But I'm back. And I'm going to do it until I can't do it anymore. I thank you, and I thank Ron for giving me this opportunity. This is only the second presentation that I've done on this matter in the last couple of months. But I hope to be able to get this article published. But it's specific for the District of Columbia. But it's replicatable all over America in urban education situations. We have a perpetual group of people who can volunteer to help a perpetual group of people. There will always be first graders, and there will always be ninth graders and 10th graders. Let's use the resources we have at our disposal and help our little children gain the educational knowledge that we know if they don't have, nothing is going to change. I thank you. Question, comment? Yes?
You are the best looking 76 old man I've ever seen in my life.
No. It's called the yoga and also walking. That's all I do. I walk and I take two yoga classes every week.
Better shape than I am.
Oh, and this happens when you take care of yourself in your 30s, 40s, and 50s. Okay? Don't happen automatically. Any other questions, comments? All right, thank you very, very much. Yes, sir. Oh, I'm sorry, man.
What can they do if you can't coach
them? What?
In the classroom?
They coax him out. The teacher cannot touch. The only time you can touch a child is when he's hurting himself or somebody else. I've seen kids destroy the room and the teacher couldn't stop. I mean, destroy it.
So they just let him destroy.
They just let him destroy. And then they suspend him. Okay. Yeah. 5-year-old, 6-year-old, you're suspended.
5-year-old, 6-year-old
is they're no bigger than they usually were. But they're still five. They're still babies. That 12-year-old who looked like a grown man has a 12-year-old of mine. That's why he was hurt. What was wrong with me? What did I do? You did not do anything. And it's the new rules. You can't touch the child unless he's hurting himself or somebody else. It's a shame. Yes, sir.
Somebody left their phone.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Everything you're talking about there sounds all well and good. And we see what happened here in 2012 in Chicago, with 500 black kids got killed, were killing themselves. But we have a lot of black organization who always coming up whenever something happened, they're always coming up and voicing their opinion. Apparently, it appears to me they just want TV space. But here you are talking about kids, little black boys, who are lack of education. And we have in this country some of the most powerful, educated black men. Who, for some reason, every Black Lives Matter young man get killed by some white man, they are on TV. The problems start where you are talking about. 6-year-olds, 5-year-olds, and cutting off the ignorance. And that particular part of it, you are the only person who is talking about it. I've heard talk about it, and I appreciate that very much. I'm almost your age, and I've seen this happen. You cannot do this alone. Why don't you open up this to all these organizations you have out there? You will not only be saving young lives, but you will transform the future if you go on that.
Well, the next step I went to see the people who were opening the high school, and they didn't necessarily feel they needed my help. Something I had done for 20 years. Oh, but that's all right, you know. I'm going to meet with President Obama's program, My Brother's Keeper. Now, I'm not doing it anymore, but I'm going to get these things published in every place I can get published. And the reason that I'm not getting a lot of, I don't know what to call it, well, is because I'm calling out black people. Okay? I ain't talking about white people. Ain't your job to raise my children. In fact, you cannot raise my children. Coaches, white coaches and white teachers and what have you, can help you along the path, but they cannot and will never be able to train you to be a black man. Now, all of us know, well, I would, when a cop stops, you don't say shit. Don't say nothing. But these young men today have grown, part of it is our fault, because we are freer than we've ever been in the history of America. But you've never heard a black person talk about the good old days, have you? Ain't no such thing for us. Today is not the good old days for black people with the way all the murder. No, I'm going to put it out there. And hey, I'm not going to do it for you anymore. I'm just not. I told them, they said I wanted a full time. I said, I'm not working full time for anybody ever again in this life. You've got to be crazy if you think I'm going to do this again at my age. I'm going to tell you. And I'm going to show you how it can be done, but it's not my job anymore. I did my part. It took me a long while to realize how much I had given up to do this. But the feedback I get from all of the kids that were in my program, one of the things, these guys are so proud, only about two of them have children out of wedlock. They are married, they have children, they are educated, they finished high school, they became bus drivers, they drive metro cars, all of the things you need a high school diploma for. So the ones that stayed with me, if they didn't stay the full 6 years, if even the ones I did research that stayed 3 years, seventh, eighth, and ninth grade, if I got you through ninth grade on grade level and functioning well, most of them went ahead and finished. But the major thing that I needed to get this done, and this is something that the schools are going to have to do, I had to have a clinical psychologist work with many of these boys. I had to get them to see that at the moment you do hate your mom because of what she's doing and what she's done and what have you. And any child that has those kind of feelings toward their mother is upset, is emotionally in turmoil. I got into a place, I said, now, I told them, all of them, listen, you go talk to Dr. So-and-so. Tell him that you hate your mom, and tell him why you hate your mom. And then we'll talk. See, they got to a point where they couldn't tell me what was going on to cause them to their grades drop. So no, something's going on here. What's going on? You can't stay with me and do this. So you gotta tell me what's causing this to happen to you. And those that I had money to have the therapists, they got through it. One of them told me, now he was in 10th grade. I had been with him since first grade. He was one of the brightest kids I had ever met in my life. 10th grade, algebra 2, and chemistry. Honors English. He quit on me. And he said to me, Doc, I said, you know I love you, Anthony. Good Lord, you can be anything you want. He said, Doc, oh, my mama don't care. I said, but I can't. You only got 2 more years, and you can go back and help her once you finish, because you can be anything you want. Mama don't care. I had a heart attack that year. A mild heart attack. And the doctor told me, this is all stress. What the hell is going on? You only had an artery that was 45% occluded. But my heart was in it, because I lost 4 boys. He was one of them. And my friends, my colleagues talked me into going to talk to a psychologist about it, because I was acting out. I was angry and mad. I was mad at God. What the hell did you do this to me for? After I gave up my college job and all that money and what have you, you're going to give me a heart attack? I didn't pray during the whole time I was in the hospital. I refused to pray. You know, you want to kill me? Go ahead. I don't care. I haven't had a problem since 1998. That was in 1998. It came from Anthony and Trump and a couple of other, these brilliant boys who were overcome. See, around 14 or 15 is when boys begin to really understand, I said it for this one, what their mamas have gone through. And they begin to realize that the negative terms like hoochie mama and that kind of thing that are used toward women describes their mother. Now, they're sitting in a school system, an educational system, where mom, the flag, and apple pie are the three Americanism, right? 2 out of 3 are mama. Mom and the apple pie. Who makes the apple pie? My mom made the best apple pie in the world. My sister couldn't duplicate it after she died either. But here is this boy confronted with who mama is supposed to be in our culture. And he has 4 or 5 siblings, sometimes by 4 or 5 different men. Now, a personal bit, I think I was 25. When I found out that my mother had an affair. 25. I responded like I was 9. I wanted to beat up my older brother for telling me. What do you mean? No, she didn't. Are you crazy? I was 25. And I couldn't believe my mama had had an affair. But at 25, I was able to understand that my father, you know, she deserved some happiness, and if she had gotten some happiness from that, it was all right. But I was 25. If I had been 9, she would have been in trouble for a long, long time. You see what I'm saying? These little boys often are treated. I had another little boy say to me, my mama hollers at me, my grandmama hollers at me, Ms. Jones, I am sick of women hollering at me. And he added, which blew me away, I can't do nothing right for women. I said, Jesus, he sounds just like a man. I can't do nothing right for a woman. Now, he comes from a female-headed household, a matriarchy in that housing project, and he's sent to school, and the first 4 or 5 years of his life, he has female teachers. And what he does is what we do sometimes. I've always said, when your mama, your wife, are on your back about something, they're generally right, but they don't know when to shut the hell up. Tell me once or twice, but you got to keep up. And then what do you do as grown men? And then, well, I'm not going to do it now. The hell with you. Told me 4 times. I heard you the first time. This is what little boys do with female teachers. They can't afford to turn Miss Jones off. But he won't sing the ABC song. If you don't sing that ABC song, you're never going to learn ABCs. That is the hook. that you get, and you're sitting down, sing the song. When they're writing, sing it, come on, come on, come on, sing the song. And some of these little boys refuse to sing. Or play the Simon Says. All of the last thing I'll say to you is primary grades, when you're dealing with pre-literate people, how do you teach them? You demonstrate. Kindergarten and primary, kindergarten and first grade, almost all of the teacher's behavior is copy me. Do this. Copy me. Let's sing the ABC song. Let's sing Simon Says. Put your little boy that I'm playing. I ain't doing that. But if you don't do it, son, you're not going to learn the lesson that is incorporated in that activity. So we see little boys turning women off. Not big. I asked one, don't you mind this? Yeah, sure, all right. Well, why won't you do it? And they give you that famous little boy's response. But I know you're so mad at your mom and the women authorities in your life that you're taking it out on these people who are here to make sure you learn these kinds of things. Okay? Thank you very, very much.